guess it's time, so we can start. First of all, thank you very much to all of you for coming here to attend to my talk, and thanks for the two organization for letting me being here speaking about CSS Grid Layout. I hope you listen me well at the end. Yeah, okay. So CSS Grid Layout from the inside out, maybe the names will be the other way around, from the out to the inside, because first we will see how it works from the outside and then from inside the browser. So let's start. Just a little bit about me. I'm part of Igalia, an open source consultancy founded back in 2001. We are from Spain, but we have people all around the globe. And we work mostly on free software projects. And we have a very big, important web platform team where we contribute to projects like WebKit, Chromium, Blink, even Servo. So we are one of the top external companies contributing to these projects. And I'm currently working on the CSS Grid Layout implementation since more than 1 year already. And we are working on the implementation on Blink and WebKit, so in Chromium and future Safari versions. So let's start. We are going to be talking about layout on the web here. I mean, CSS Grid Layout is an spec for that exactly. And I guess all of you know that the web is full of grids. There are grids everywhere. I mean, in any web page you open, or almost any web page you open, there are always a header. There are some columns. There are items that span a picture that span two columns or whatever. So we have grids everywhere. And this is not something new. If we go back in time to 1996, we see that the New York Times website was already a grid. Somehow, it has a footer, it has three columns. So this has been here forever, and we have been trying to solve the same issue for a long time. And probably you know better than me this part, because you are usually working on websites and so on, but I guess that most of you use a table the first time you write a website, just to put the elements on the website and say, okay, table works pretty nice, it seems, but at the end it was something horrible. It was not like a good solution, it was, you were mixing the style of your page with the content of your page, so not the good solution. Then we have floats, which are really nice if you want to float an image on the left and the text on the right, so that works pretty well. That's the purpose of floats. But if you start trying to create several columns or maybe rows or whatever with floats, and then you have to do clear fixes here and there, and things become very messy, so not the solution either. Also, we have inline block, and it works for some use cases, but it's not the good solution. Also, we have display table. Again, it's a good solution in some cases. At least you separate the style from the markup, but it's not the right solution. And then, in the last years, there are a lot of CSS frameworks that are emerging, and they are actually quite good, and they save you from all this mess with floats. They actually use floats or inline blocks behind the scenes, but for you, they are transparent. You just put a few classes in your HTML elements, and you are done. And they are pretty good. The problem is that there are so many. I mean, almost every week or every month there are a new CSS framework for doing grid layouts, that is very hard to choose the good one. And when you choose one, maybe you are in the middle of your project and you miss a few features that are in other, and you cannot change everything. So it's not the perfect solution either. And then from the W3C, especially from the CSS working group, there are some new specs thinking to solve this problem. And one of them is CSS Flexbox. I guess several of you already tried it or are already using it, because it's implemented in a lot of browsers. And it's really nice for one-dimensional layouts. So if you want to take advantage of this page in the horizontal space in a page, and you want to have several items and define how they should grow or shrink depending on the available space, if they should grab to the next line if there are not enough space. So that's for that, Flexbox is really great. But if you want to create a grid, you have to do nested Flexbox, one horizontally, one vertically, and then sometimes nested and nested and nested Flexbox. So when you want to move things in the page from one part to another, things become more complicated, and they are not thought for that. And for that purpose, for two-dimensional layouts, we have CSS Grid Layout spec, which is where I'm going to be talking here, and it's a new spec that is about to be on several browsers implemented, and you could start using in the next years or whatever. But I think that is the best solution that we have right now for creating grids on a web. So grid layout is mostly to create two-dimensional layout, so you can have defined columns and rows, and you can define how the sizing behaviors of the columns and rows will be, if they should grow, if they should shrink, depending on the space, if they should have a fixed size or whatever. And I'm going to review several grid concepts just in case that we are all in the same page, because I'm going to be using them during the whole presentation. So this is a very simple grid with a header and a side main and footer. And here what we have is the grid lines. This is the most important concept probably from the CSS grid layout spec, because the lines are actually numbered in the grid layout spec. So we have 3 vertical lines and 4 horizontal lines, and each line has a number. So when we are placing the header, we are placing it between the first and the second horizontal lines, and between the first and the third vertical lines. So that's how we define where we place the elements. So the lines are really important. Then we have the grid trash, which are both the rows and the columns. In this simple grid, we have 3 rows, and we have 2 columns. And then we have the grid cells. I guess all of you know what this is. So in this case, we have 6 cells. Every of the single cells that you are defining with your columns and rows on the grid, with your lines. And then we have another concept that are the grid areas. For example, in this case, the first row completely, we can define that this is an area. So it's taking 2 cells, not only 1. And we place elements directly on an area. We can place the elements on a cell or on an area directly. So I'm going to go through the CSS grid layout syntax. But the spec is huge. There are a lot of syntax, and there are a lot of options to do several things. So I will try to go fast and just explaining the main features that you get the idea, but you are not going to know how to use everything just because of the presentation, because it's like too much things. So everything starts with a new value for the display property, which is grid. It's similar to with Flexbox, you use display flex. And we also have display inline grid if needed. So with display grid, the important thing is when you put display grid to an element, that element becomes a grid container. So that means that the children of that element are grid items, and you are setting a new formatting context. So the children of that element doesn't follow the regular flow of the page, so they are not layout like a regular block, like if you are not marking a grid, but they are following the rules defined by the CSS grid layout spec. So we will see how it works. So first step is defining the size of the tracks in the grid, the columns and the rows. And for that, we have 2 properties, grid template columns and grid template rows, long names, but easy to remember. And the good part here is that we are actually creating boxes from CSS. So just with these columns, we are creating boxes on the page, and we are later placing the things on those boxes, and we don't need a wrapper element for them and things like that. So let's see how they work. So we have here a very simple HTML with a grid container and then 4 items. So we say that this is a grid, and then we can define the size of the columns with this property. And we have 3 sizing behaviors for in the grid layout spec. We can use fixed sizing, we can use intrinsic sizing, so depending on the content, and we can use flexible sizing that depends on the available space. So let's start for the simplest one. If we say 100 pixels for the first column, 200 pixels for the second column, so you see that it's working, and we can say the same for the rows, or maybe we want the second one 150 pixels or whatever. So we have defined with fixed sizing, with specific fixed sizes, the size of the columns and the rows.
What defines the gutter? How much space in the gutter?
Yeah, that gutter, we will see later. That's just a small padding I put in order to watch everything better. I mean, but it's a small padding that the elements have right now. We'll see the gutters later. So apart from fixed sizing, we can use intrinsic sizing. That, for example, there is the keyword auto. So it adapts to the content. So if the B has a width of 200 pixels, you see that is already adapting to the content, so it depends on the size of the item. And probably you already realized that the default example and the C are quite high because they are stretching by default. The grid items are like flex items, so they stretch by default both horizontally and vertically. In a regular block, you only stretch horizontally. You take the, but not vertically, and in grid, we are doing that. And the other sizing method is flexible sizing. So you say 1FR, and it's a new unit that is called free space, which is the use the available space. And you can have like 1FR, 1FR, and we have three columns using the available space. And if we use 2FR, it's taking the double space. And the other one is similar in Flexbox with grid grow, flex grow one, flex grow two, if you are used to that. So this is pretty similar.
What FR stands for again? Flex
grow? No, free space. So it's like one proportion of the free space, two proportions or something like that. Two fractions or whatever. And okay, so we have the three methods, maybe the three in the same to see how it works. So fixed, intrinsic, and flexible. And then we have some utilities methods. Maybe I'm just going to explain one of them, repeat. For example, we can say repeat, two, 100 pixels, 50 pixels. So you see that we are creating at least four columns, one of 100, one of 50, one of 100, one of 50. Okay, so now that we know how to create the structure of the grid and the columns and the rows and the size of those, we have to place the elements there. So we have the placement properties. We have grid column and grid row. And the important thing here is that the source DOM order will be completely independent on the visual order. We can very easily move things on the web, and the source order, we don't have to change anything on the HTML. And this is very important regarding accessibility, because we can have a very good order on the HTML document on the DOM, so that the screen readers don't have problems to follow it, or the tab navigation don't have problems. And then we don't have to compromise that order in order to have a good layout on the web, because we can put the things where we need. So it's always important to keep a good order on the DOM for reasons like accessibility and so on. So we have now agreed. I'm using a shortcut because it's short for this presentation, but we have two columns and two rows. The columns are 200 pixels wide. So we can put the elements. So for example, I can say that the A should be in the second row and in the second column. And it's that easy like that. So we are already breaking the order between the HTML order and the visual order. So we can also say that the B spans two columns, saying that span two, for example. So the B is taking two columns, or maybe we want that it takes two rows. That was not easy at all with most of the CSS frameworks spanning vertically. I mean, horizontally is always easy, but vertically is usually a mess. So, and spanning two is the same like if we are saying from line one to line three, because if you remember, the lines were numbered, so we have first, second, and third horizontal line, so we are from one to three. Or if we put something on the three line, it goes outside of the other grid because we are adding rows on demand. And that's all regarding placement. So we also have, instead of using the number for the name, for the lines, we can use names. So we can put names to the lines in order that it's easier for us to maintain the CSS. So a line can have not just one name, but several names. So you can always reference it with the index. That's the minimum thing, but you can also reference it with names if you need it. So here I'm creating a grid with just two columns, and I put in names to the lines, and these are between brackets. So the first line is called left two, the middle line is called middle, but also center. So I have two names for that line, and the third line is called right. So if I put the A in the line two, it's the same that if I put it in the center or in the middle, if I write it properly. So we can reference it, and we can also span from the left to the right. So we are from the line left to the line right, and it's the same if we say the three, because it's the same line. And the same I can put it directly on the right and it goes, because that's the first line for it. So another interesting property is grid template areas that allows you to create areas directly on the grid, and then you put the elements there, the areas we were talking in the concepts before. And for that, we use ASCII art. You don't have to be an expert in ASCII art. It's very simple, but it's nice, I think, because it's pretty easy to understand, I think. We have the grid template areas property, and we have the first row here is the head. So we put head, and then we put nav on the left, main on the right, and foot for the last row. And then we place the items directly on those areas with grid area property. So we put the A on the head, the B on the main, the C on the nav, and the D on the foot. And then we can very easily change this and say, okay, but I want the nav to be on the other side, so I put here main and here nav, and nav is already on the other side. But I want nav also to be here and to be here, so it changes very easily. I want the head to be like that and the main be a bit bigger, and the foot, but I don't like it, this, and I put the foot, and maybe I want just a gap here. So you can very easily change everything, and it's a very powerful property and very simple to understand, I think. I don't know if it's hard to understand. So you can play with it and you move everything on the web very easily. So it's really nice. And the one dot or several dots are the same, are for defining a gap. So alignment. If you are using Flexbox, you already know that alignment in Flexbox is supported. So when they were writing the CSS Grid Layout spec, they were adding the same properties to the spec, and then they realized that they should create a generalization that the CSS box alignment spec that we are implementing on grid. And the thing is, for sure you have listened a lot of jokes about centering on CSS, and you know that with Flexbox is already easy, and with grid is the same. So we have the properties align items and justify items. We have here a grid with three items, two columns and two rows, and the C item is spanning two columns, just in order that you see how it works. So align items center, items are centered vertically, and you want to do the same horizontally, the same for justify items. And so centering in CSS is never hard. It's going to be easy in the future for sure, and with Flexbox it's already easy. And then if you want a specific item to do something different, for example, I want it to keep stretching, or I want this at the bottom, so I put end in justify self, end in justify self, and I align it as I want it inside the area where it's placed, in this case a cell. The C1 is in the middle because it was taking the two columns. And we can even do more things with alignment, not only align the items itself, but also the tracks. This is similar to what we have in Flexbox too with align content, justify content, so it's pretty similar. We can say, okay, I want to center everything. Or we can say, I want the space between. So it adds space between the rows or space around. Like the C item is spanning two columns, it's spanning all the width. So this is very similar to what we have in Flexbox. We have a new keyword, space heavenly, but it's pretty similar everything. So about the gutters that were asked before the question. So we have, this was not in the spec in June. So it was added in June actually, because several people was asking for this. And we have now two new properties, grid row gap and grid column gap, that allows you to set the size of the gaps to separate the tracks in the grid, so they are not complex to understand, they are already implemented. So we have a grid with five items, three columns and two rows, and we say, okay, I want a 20 pixels gap, so it's adding a gap there, maybe a bigger one in order that you see it better. 50 pixels, and you can say that the column gap should be 50 pixels too. So it's adding gaps between the tracks. And if an item is spanning two columns, like the D1, you see that it also takes the gap because it's part of the area. So auto placement. Probably you realized during the presentation that I was only saying grid row, grid column to the first items that I place, but the rest of the items are placed automatically, like these ones, like the previous slide. And that's because the auto-placement algorithm that is looking for empty space on the grid and putting the items there. And you can control the direction if it grows by the creating new rows or creating columns with the grid autoflow property. So this is like the canonical example for the auto-placement property feature. So we have a regular form, just form, label, input, very simple, label, input, a button, and a form. And of course, it renders all the way. So we can say that this is a grid. So it's creating rows, one row per item. And we can say grid out of flow column if we want it to grow to the other direction, but we don't want that now. So row is the default one. And then we can say, OK, the labels will be on the first column, and the input will be on the second one. And it's looking better. And maybe the button can be spanning two columns because we have enough space. And even why not justify self-center? It's looking better. And maybe the labels justify self-right. Yeah? So just a few lines, maybe grid gap, just to make it even beautiful. I mean, just a few lines, and we are, without modifying the HTML at all, we are creating a nice form, just with a few lines of CSS. And last thing, not because you use grid layout you are going to create responsive designs. I mean, you have to do something else, not only using grid layout. But thanks to the properties like the flexible sizing, the one-third, things like that, that will help you to create responsive designs. And also, if you combine that with media queries, you will see that it can change completely the layout of your web page, and you don't have to modify at all the HTML, just a few CSS lines. So imagine that we have a grid that has two columns and three rows. So we are using the grid template areas here. The first row is the header. We have the side on the left and the main and the footer. But if it goes under 400 pixels, we just want one column for a mobile phone or whatever. So we don't have to modify the HTML. Just change the grid template areas. We change also the sizes of the columns and the rows. So the main one always have the available space. So this is the grid. And if we resize it, we see that it changed. And we don't have to modify anything at all on the HTML. And you can change to whatever position, even hide some items or whatever you need. So this is all what is already implemented, and that you can already start to play with it. And about the future, there are some other things that have been added lately to the spec. One of them is auto-repeat. So we have the repeat function that I showed you before, that you can say repeat two and create a pattern two times or whatever to create columns or rows. So with the autofill and autofit keywords for that function, that will be automatically depending on the available space. So let's show an example. This is not actually working like that, but this is an example to see how this will work once it's ready. There are still discussions about the final syntax for this and the final behavior, but this is the idea. You have agreed with five items here, and we have repeat autofill 100 pixels. That means that for the available space, you create as many columns as possible. So in this case, it has space to create four columns. But if it's the space change, it creates just one column or two columns or three columns. So that's automatically controlled by the auto repeat feature. Another thing that will come, that part is already in the spec, the auto-repeat, that is, sorry, but it's being discussed and not implemented yet completely. Another thing is subgrids, which are quite complex, maybe, to try to explain, but I will try. Feature that are right now marked as at risk in the spec, so they will be probably moved to the next level of the spec, so they are not implemented yet on any browser, and probably the implementation will need more time, but I will explain it anyway. So we have nested grids already implemented, so you can have a grid, and inside an item, you can have another grid. So for example, the one on the left, we can have 5 items, and the 6th item could be a subgrid with 4 sub items somehow. But as you see, there are not any relationship with the track sizing between the parent grid and the other grid. They are independent grids. They are one inside the other, but they don't know anything about the parent. But if we use a subgrid, the subgrid is sharing the same track sizing information with the parent. So the columns and the rows will be exactly the same size. So we could put the elements there, and they will be perfectly aligned with the other. I will try to explain with the auto placement example we used before, but now with a more real form where I guess you have created a form like that with an UL and LI for each label and input, a list item for each label and input, and so on. So we have the UL is a grid, and each LI is a grid again. And we put the label on the left, the input on the right. But we see that there are not alignment at all here, because they are each LI is an independent grid completely. So they don't know anything about the other. If we could use subgrid here that is not implemented yet, then it will be perfectly aligned like in the other example, because we know the same track sizing information and the parent. So at the end, it's like these items are somehow you can place them directly on the parent grid. Not exactly like that, but just to understand it. So now that we review all the syntax, and more or less, you know, almost all the syntax about how grid works and how you can use grids, I'm going to try to explain, because I'm working on the implementation, so I'm going to try to explain how this works on the browser, what steps we need to do in the browser in order to lay out a grid, because this is important for the people using it, because if you know what's more complex or less complex, you can try to avoid some features or others and have a faster grid or solve some performance issues, because if you just use something and you don't know how it works behind the scenes, maybe you are missing some important, just using some single feature, you are breaking all the performance of your grid or whatever. So let's use this example that has 5 items, and it has 3 columns and 2 rows. We can see it here. So it has a fixed column, a flexible column, and an intrinsic column to explain how all of them work, and 2 rows. And we are putting the elements in different places. So mostly the browser, summarizing the work, we have to place the items on the grid. That's the first step. Then we have to calculate the size of the columns and the rows, and then we have to lay out the items there. So first thing is placing the items. We know that we have 3 rows and 2 columns. So let's start placing them. So this step is pretty easy. I mean, title should be in the first row and the second column, so we put it there. Nav should be in the second row, first column. The main content should be on the second row and second column. And then we have add, for example, that we only specify that this should be in the third column. We don't say anything about the row. So it looks for the first empty space in that row. So the first row was empty. But the first word was already took by add, so it goes to the second row. So we have the items already placed on the grid, and we can start to calculate the size of the columns and the rows. First, we start for the columns. So the first one is very easy because it's a fixed size, so we just say, okay, 200 pixels, that's all. We put the size for the column and we are done. The second column had a flexible sizing, 1FR, so for flexible sizing, they use the available space, so we need to calculate the other columns before, the fixed ones and the intrinsic ones. So we go to the third one, which is an intrinsic column, and it has auto. So it has to adapt itself to the content. So for that, it has to ask all the items in that column, what's your size, what's your width? So the ad says, okay, my size is 60 pixels. The ad word says, okay, mine is 130 pixels. So okay, we take 130 pixels, and we have the size for that column too. And for the middle column, it's a flexible one. It uses the available space. I put a fixed size to the grid to make the calculations easier, that of 800 pixels. So we have just to do the subtraction, and we have 470 pixels for the middle column. And now we know what's the size of each column, and we can say the items. Use this width for layout yourself to know how high is going to be your height and so on. So we have the title, the ad, the nav, and so on. So we move to the rows now to calculate the sizes of the rows. The first one is again easy, 100 pixels. We don't have to do anything else. And the second one is auto again, so it's intrinsic sizing row. So we have to ask again the items in that row. What's your height? So 60 pixels, 160, 60 pixels. So we get the biggest one, 160. And since we are done, yeah? But we are still missing one extra step because by default, the items stretch vertically too, as I explained it before. So we can to lay out the items again and take advantage of all the space they have. And yes, now we are done. So we have our grid. It was a bunch of steps. And this is like the most simple use case that you can find, because if you have items spanning several columns, several rows, things like that, then the algorithm is much more complex.
And then back to the gutters again. When are gutters figured out in this, after they've kind of done the spacing, and then gutters are?
The gutters are considered like fixed rows or fixed columns or fixed rows because you are setting 50 pixels. So that's like when you are processing the columns, you consider that is a fixed column, and that's all. You don't need to do anything extra. So now that we know how do we grid goals, how can we make them faster? So probably the first thing all of you realize is that if we use fixed sizing, it's going to be faster than intrinsic. We don't have to ask or all the items in that row or in that column what's their size. We just have 200 pixels, we are done, we have the size. So
if some
nice
element wider than 200 pixels.
It overflows. So if there are, he's asking if there are one element is wider than 200 pixels, what happens? So it will overflow. You're defining is like you have, let me go to the, we are defining the like containing blocks for each item. We don't have that on the HTML, but it's the same like if you have a div wrapper with 200 pixels width or whatever. So if you don't fill inside, you just overflow. So fixed sizing is 60% faster on a 20 rows and 10 columns grid, and if the grid is bigger, it's 100% faster on a 100 times 20 grid and 140. So the biggest the grid is, the biggest the performance improvement you have if you use fixed sizing. Of course, you cannot use always, but. And also, intrinsic sizing is faster than flexible sizing because when you are using 1FR, 2FR, you have to do fractions to divide the available space, and that operation is pretty costly. So usually it's 40% faster in big grids. And also there are other things. By default, they stretch vertically, as I explained it, but a regular block will be doing something like this. No? Will be taking the width, but not the height. So like we are, if we use a stretch, which is the default one, we are being 20% slower than if we use a stair or center or something like that vertically. So if we don't actually need a stretch, we can use align items start, and we are saving some this extra operation. We have to do that, as you see, an extra step at the end. And similar for the width, if we use justify self start, and we are avoiding the stretch that is usually happening, we are 10% slower than if we are doing the default option. So about the status of all of this, because I haven't been told you a lot of marvelous things about grid layout, a lot of things that you could do, but what's the status? So there is a W3C specification, and that's the link to the editor's draft. And actually, if you are playing with a new spec like this or other new specs, you should take a look to the editor's draft, because the other are usually old, and I mean they are not updated, and probably the implementations are following the editor's draft. This spec was started in the times of Windows 8 by Microsoft, and now it's been evolved. The editors are from Microsoft, Google, and Mozilla, or independent now, I'm not sure. And the last working draft is from September of this year, where several features have been added, like And they are still evolving, so if you start to play with grid, you can provide feedback, you can say, okay, I'm missing this feature, or I'm missing this other feature. Things like the gutters that were not there 4 months ago are now in the spec, are now implemented. So you have the chance to start to play with it, test it, and say, okay, I'm missing this and that, and talk with the W3C, with the CSS working group, and so on, and convince them that this feature is important for grid or, and things like that. The goal is that the spec moves to last call working draft past the TPAC that is happening like in 2 weeks or in 1 week or two at the end of the month. So the spec is quite getting to a stable point. So we are like in the last minute to do changes on the spec and so on. And last thing, Igalia has started to work on the W3C test suite for grid layout. Maybe you don't know this, but there are test suites in the W3C repositories for all the specs and for CSS2 and so on. And they are just a bunch of small HTML pages testing one or two features of one spec or things like that, very simple HTML. And if you could contribute to the grid layout one or to another ones, they are very useful for browser interoperability. So you create a few tests that check 3 or 4 features in any spec, and you can check if they pass in all the browsers or not, and so on. And it's just creating pull requests in a repository, and someone will review it and will get integrated. So it's not something very hard to do. So this is the bad news. Can I use grid? If you go to the web page, it says clearly that you cannot. But this is not exactly the reality. So let's go to the good part. Regarding browser adoption, so there you can actually use grid in Microsoft in internet since Internet Explorer 10. So it's been a while since you can use grid. It's an old implementation. You don't have all the features that I have explained, but the basic stuff to create tracks and put elements there, put items there, place items and so on, you have it. It's prefixed with MS. And the implementation in Microsoft Edge is the same one, but they have in the top priorities list to update it. So I guess that when the spec is stable or in last call, they will update it. The most complete implementation is on Chromium, because that's our primary focus. We are working, our primary focus is Chromium. We are 3 people working on the grid layout implementation there. It's behind a flag, but you can test it in your Chromium. You just have to enable the experimental web platform feature flag. I'm actually using Chrome Canary to show this presentation. So all what I've been showing, except the future section, the rest, is already in Chrome Canary. So you can play with it, start checking it, and see if it's enough or not for your use case. Also on WebKit, we are keeping them doing the implementation too, because the code is still similar. Since the fork, it has changed a lot of things, but the layout code is pretty similar, so we are keeping the implementation ongoing, and it's missing maybe 1 or 2 features, not the ones that I'll explain it today, but others, other stuff. But it's almost the same than the one in Chromium. It's lagging a bit behind, but not a lot. But in that case, it's prefixed with the WebKit prefix, and it's enabled by default in the WebKit nightlies. And Apple doesn't talk publicly about plans for Safari, so we don't know if they are going to add it or not. But we guess that once it's shipped in Chromium, they will be adding it. About Chromium, we have the plan to send intent to ship to the developer's mailing list early in November or something like that, as soon as we fix a few small patches that we have. And let's see how the community responds, and probably we hope to ship it, if not this year, next year for sure. So it will be shipped by default there. And regarding Firefox, the implementation has started this year, and it has been advanced quite a lot, and you can start to play with it and test several examples. It's not as complete as the other ones, but you can use it already, and it's behind a flag too. And then if you are using an older browser or you want to test it there, you have a polyfill that is quite complete, and you can use it for playing with grid layout and learning the implementation, the specification. So there are some webs with examples. One of them is our our GitHub repository where we are uploading small examples and small demos when we implement a feature just to test it and so on. We upload it there. And there are also a very nice web page by Rachel Andrew, who is usually giving talks about grid layout in several conferences, and he knows better than us how to do websites, so their samples are better than us. So you can check those and see how it works, the different examples and so on. And last, I would like to publicly thank Bloomberg because they are sponsoring our work on this feature. So without their help, it won't be possible that grids should be so close to be available in the browsers. Even the spec won't be evolving so fast because, I mean, we are pushing the spec forward. We are implementing things that have edited like just a few months ago, and we are finding issues, and the spec changed again, and things like that. So that's kind of the things that big companies can do, like moving the things forward. Even if they are not browser vendors, they can talk with companies like us and help to move specs forward, implement some features that you are missing on the web and the different open source browsers and so on. And that's all from my side. Thank you very much. And if you have any question, you can. Okay.
Sorry, I'm monopolizing all the questions. That polyfill.
Yeah.
How performant is it? Like, is it pretty good, or do you take a really big performance hit by dropping that polyfill? Yeah.
So he's asking about the polyfill. What's the performance of the polyfill? I haven't do benchmarks about that, but when you try to use it, it's actually slow. So you notice that it's lower than the actual implementation, but I cannot say the numbers, but you notice it just using it.
Oh, really? Okay. Thanks.
So it's good for playing with it, but not for production at all.
Gotcha. Cool. Thanks for the talk.
Are these slides available?
Yeah. Sorry. I forgot to tell that. The slides are available on my blog. So you can go there to the resources page, and I will do a tweet later about the slides too.